My name is Lisa Anderson, and I'm the Dean of the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia University, where we are now. Joining me on the dais to pose some questions to you is John Alterman, who is the Director of the Middle East Program at the Center for International and Strategic Studies in Washington, D.C. We've had a very productive 2 days of conversations and debates about the prospects for democracy with, as you know, the largest group of Libyan academics and policymakers to visit the United States in 25 years. So this is a set of questions that we've been debating for several days, and we would like to pose some of the questions that have come out of our discussions to you to see your vision of how democracy is going to be understood in Libya, in the United States, in the world, and how you think that the growing engagement of Libya with the world in the last few years and in the future will be shaping that. So let me start perhaps with a question that has come up in our deliberations several times in the last several days. We've been talking a lot about the strengths and weaknesses of different models of democracy. And one of the ones, obviously, that's most significant to Libya is what we've been calling direct democracy, the system of people's congresses that is in place in Libya. Many of our American and European colleagues view this system of democracy as very effective at the local level, but don't quite understand how it can be utilized on a large-scale national level. So we'd like to ask you to perhaps explain how the system of direct democracy, as we say, scales up and works on a larger national level.
Thank you. Good evening, Ms. Lisa, and to all your distinguished guests. I greet all of you, and I do thank you for this initiative. I always call the word for debate, for discussion, in order to reach some right understanding in a bid to understand each other. To my mind, this is perhaps the best way for the humankind, rather than talking and discussing via missiles and sanctions, threats, intimidation, and warships that wreaked havoc in the life of mankind. And therefore, we have to be prudent. And since the world has become one small village, one common human interest, the whole members of the international community should cooperate in order to safeguard this village, this planet, and its population. In response to your query, madam, first of all, the word democracy means, demo means people, krasi, chersi, in Arabic kerasi, the plural form of kursi, chair. Therefore, it should not be called democracy because there is no state with a democracy except Libya on the whole planet. This is not propaganda. This is not rhetorical. If you'd like to see the realities on the ground, you come to Libya where you see people sitting on chairs. That is democracy. The Libyan democracy, there is, without Libyan democracy, all countries are ruled by representatives at best, in best cases. Of course, most elections are rigged, and the number of people who vote is relatively small, and those who win majority becomes the ruler, and those who got, for instance, 25%, while others who got less than 25%, that is considered as majority compared to those who obtained 24, 15, or 10. That is a travesty of democracy. Peoples have recognized this injustice and decided to decline from this farce of democracy. And the number of those who cast their ballots in votings is on the decrease. This is not genuine democracy.
ويقرر مصيره مئات الأشخاص أو أحيانا عشرات الأشخاص وتكون ديمقراطية هذه ليست ديمقراطية ثم أن الشعب الذي يحكمه حزب هو يعني هذه حكم أقلية هذا وحادية يعني فردية لكن في ليبيا الشعب يحكم نفسه بنفسه ما فيه معارض غير معارض تعارض من يعني اللي عنده رأي يقوله في المؤتمر الشعبي يعني الآن في ليبيا عدد سكان ليبيا 5 ملايين منهم 3 ملايين قادرين على ممارسة السلطة يعني حضور المؤتمرات وتقرير وممارسة السلطة ممارسة السلطة المليونين بين أطفال وبين ناس عاجزين أو ناس ظروفهم ما تسمح لهمش بالمشاركة بمرض أو غياب أو إلى آخره لكن الحد العدد الصحيح هو تقريبا 3 ملايين رجال ونساء فهؤلاء 3 ملايين عبون أنفسهم في 30,000 كومونة يعني 30,000 مؤتمر شعبي أساسي يعني 30,000 برلمان 30,000 كونغرس رجال ونساء كل من بلغ سن الرشد سن 17 أو 18 في المطور هؤلاء هم الذين يرسمون سياسة الجماهيرية والجماهيرية تعني دولة الجماهير الرجال والنساء والعالم كما تعلمون يعني تطور من الفردية اللي هي الملكية التي كان الفرد يحكم ويملك الأرض ومن عليها الآن بعد ذلك وضعت في المتاحف هذه المرحلة وتجاوزتها البشرية مرحلة الملكية وأن الملك يظل الله في الأرض وأن الملك يملك الأرض ومن عليها والوراثة ما الوراثة وبعد ذلك دخل العالم بالتطور إلى مرحلة ثانية وهي مرحلة الجمهورية أن الناس أصبح لهم الحق في اختيار الملك يعني رئيس الجمهورية هو اعتبارا عن ملك منتخب لمدة معينة أو لمدة متتالية أو حتى لمدى الحياة يعني المهم أن الذي كان يملك الملك ويأتي بدون الناس ما تعلم عليه من أين أتى أصبح الآن منتخب يعني الناس تنتخب تختار من يحكمها هذه مرحلة الجمهورية المرحلة الثالثة والنهائية هي مرحلة الجماهيرية التي فيها تحكم الناس نفسها بنفسها دون أن تنتخب أو تختار من يحكمها الناس وصلت لدرجة من الوعي أن هي تريد أن تحكم نفسها بنفسها لكن الشيء العملي في هذا كان غائب يعني كيف الناس تحكم نفسها بنفسها يقال أنه مستحيل خاصة عندما تكون دولة كبيرة مثل الصين أو الهند أو أمريكا ولكن الجواب هو بالعكس الدولة الكبيرة هي التي يجب أن تكون جماهيرية الدولة الصغيرة هي اللي ممكن يحكمها عدد قليل يحكمها حتى فرد تدار من أي إدارة تدار مركزيا لكن الدولة الكبيرة لا يمكن أن تدار وتمارس فيها السلطة إلا بالنظام الجماهيري إلا بالمؤتمرات الشعبية واللجان الشعبية إذا جاء الجواب في الكتاب الأخضر وهو أن الحل في أن تقام برلمانات في كل مكان يدخل فيها كل الناس ولا نغيب الشعب ونأتي بنواب بدلهم في النيابة عن الشعب هذه غير 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 صحيحة يعني التمثيل تجيل والتمثيل تجيل والحياة الحكم والسلطة
The rule of life exercising power is a trust it's an aspiration it's a dream no one can dream the representative cannot dream on behalf of those whom he represents And therefore, the people is marginalized, excluded by mere voting for a representative. That is not democracy. This is dictatorship. So in our view, all systems in the world are dictatorial systems because they are a bunch of people, representatives, who act on behalf of their peoples. The proof of the failure of those systems is that peoples do not depend on the elected councils out of vacuum or for fun to vote. Now, the crowd in the street requires something else, while the parliament in its chambers cannot express and capture those demands. What we see from those demonstrations is that the representatives are not representing the people. If that is the case, why do people go out to the street and call for withdrawal of occupation forces and to achieve peace, but the protest against law? How could we explain how people are protesting a law if the parliament has enacted that law? If that parliament represents the people, then how could we explain and understand that the people are out in the street protesting that law? This means that this representation is fake. It is so in Libya, the people of Libya enact all laws. There would be no law in Libya which has the rule of the force of law unless the people's congresses endorse it. Those congresses represent and are a forum for 3 million people. The General People's Congress is not a parliament, as you might imagine. The General People's Congress is a congress of all representatives in the People's Congress who would vote on the basis of decisions taken by the basic people's congresses. And that is the form of the democracy. Everything else is false and fake.
Okay,
and I do thank you.
I actually have, a follow-up question to this, though, because one of the things that puzzles people outside of Libya about how the system works is that although there are 30,000 small-scale congresses, there are clearly people in diplomatic representation of the country. So how are these 30,000 basic people's congresses related to the people who are representing Libya in foreign embassies and so forth and so on? There has to be some system by which the 30,000 congresses can express their opinions and ensure that their views are in some way collected and represented outside the country.
I think is an escape from the difficulty that this Congress finds itself in. We are seeking small, marginal issues that are of no consequence in order to alleviate the impact of a strong and compelling, if not embarrassing, answer in terms of democracy. Is democracy, in your view, madam, takes a manifestation of representation in embassies or diplomatic missions? Suppose that a country does not have large diplomatic missions overseas, 10 missions, for instance. What has this to do with democracy? Libyan diplomats who serve overseas are part of a General People's Committee for Foreign Liaison and International Cooperation, and that emerges from the People's Congresses. That committee appoints Libyan diplomats, and the people has mandated it to take care of foreign relations and international cooperation. This is different from your system when see the president or the prime minister appoints the foreign secretary or secretary of state who would in turn appoint diplomats overseas. That is a government system. And the government system is not popular, it is hated because there is a ruler and a ruled or subject. And we do not accept that. Who are you in order to rule me? The common man in the street in this time and age, I don't want anyone to rule me. No one can determine my future on my behalf. No one can set my fate for my for me.
Sir, may I ask a question, please?
And
what you've described in Libya is a quite unique system in the world, as you've said, and over the 36 years since the Libyan Revolution, the world has changed a tremendous amount, and Libya is opening up to embrace that change with the creation of 1-9 Media, allowing foreign media in. I was in Tripoli in January and saw satellite dishes on rooftops all over the city. How do you see these changes affecting Libya, and how do you see this opening up of the Libyan system affecting the uniqueness that Libya has had for the last 36 years?
What do you mean exactly by the word unique? Could you please explain?
The Jamahiriya system that you have described has not been implemented in any country other than Libya. It remains a unique Libyan experience.
In any case, the word has changed indeed, and the transformation has been caused by modern means of communications and inventions. But that change, which took place in the past, involved certain aspects, certain phenomenon that did not concern the whole world. Now, Athens, like Libya, it was in 4th century before Christ, but then the world did not hear anything about Athens then, because they had no means of modern communication, no television sets, no phones, but we read about it in books. Even in Libya, if there was a population in America at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, they might not have heard of a prophet who came to advocate the cause of Islam, to embrace Islam, and perhaps the United States would have become Muslim, but because lack of modern means of communication, they did not hear of him. Now, they read about a new prophet because of means of communication. And now they claim that they did not hear of that prophet. In other words, the Libyan would benefit from the information revolution and will eventually spread across the globe. Now, the people in Europe, Americas, Asia, and Africa would know that there is a system that would save them from this drama, rigged elections, false representation, and that the wealthy should become the ruler, the head of the state, and who can mount an election campaign that is effective. The wealthy people who control these matters. And the world has started to understand and appreciate that through the modern means of communications and telecommunications. And now they have started to know that there are people's congresses in Libya that would achieve global peace if peoples ruled without governments, without leaders, because the peoples love each other and they do not want war. No people in his country would leave its country in order to invade another country, but armies, organized armies, upon instructions from their rulers, would leave their countries to invade others. But peoples are not allowed to do so now. And therefore, I think the Jamahiri system in the third stage, which is the final one, will prevail through the revolution of modern technology and communications. Thank you.
Do you see any possibility that, in fact, the changes may go both ways, and that while the world may become more familiar with the Jamahiri system, Libyans may become more familiar with other systems and wish to experiment with them?
That is the Jamahiri system, but the Republican system, the party, government, or parliamentary system, it is well known to the Libyans. Before the revolution in Libya, there were elections, false elections, there was a House of Representatives, there were government, the ruler, the ruled, neighboring countries had similar government systems. So all these systems are well known to the people of Libya. And the people of Libya should not be surprised by parties, because this is deja vu for the Libyans. In Libya, there were political parties before independence, and they tested that, and they abandoned that because this republic, monarchy system, parliamentary system, all these systems are well known to the Libyan people. There is nothing new here. Quite the opposite. What they know about them very well is their falsification. They tested the false elections, and people mount demonstrations while they have a House of Representatives, a parliament. Why the parliament, the House of Representatives, would not act on their behalf? That is the privilege of the Libyan people. If anything, this would be a credit to the Jamahiri system. The world would be surprised that there is something totally new, different to what they have. That is, people's congresses, people's committees, the Jamahiri system, the authority of the people. This is something totally new for the whole world, and the world would be surprised to discover and probably embrace this. Thank you.
Let me, if I may, move to other impacts that the engagement of Libya with the rest of the world is likely to have. There's been a lot of talk about reform, not necessarily at the political level, but at social and economic levels. Do you anticipate that this engagement, the increasing involvement of Libya and the rest of the world, and the rest of the world in Libya, is going to have an impact in reforming other sectors and segments of Libyan society?
The world is duty bound to get acquainted with the Libyan system and to draw lessons from it, the system of People's Congresses, the direct democracy forum. I think countries like the United States, India, China, Russian Federation are in bad need for the Jamahiri system in order to run these big sectors, huge institutions that cover this wide tract of land like the United States of America, China, Russian Federation. They do need to know how the system of people's congresses and people's committees operate, because this is a savior for them, to my mind. And all those systems would benefit, those peoples would benefit, and opening up would benefit our theory. Even the economic system, we argue that people's capitalism the asset or national wealth should be distributed equally among all people. Call it populist capitalism or socialist, popular socialism. That is our vision. In view of the global crisis, politically, economically, socially, the political crisis emanates from the dictatorships in the world and the neglect of people and their interests, and people are resorted to when they are called upon to vote for a group, for a powerful person or a group of persons. With regard to wealth, now we are seeing an economic crisis because the wealth is concentrated in the hands of few, and the majority of world population are suffering from hunger, poverty, deprivation, hunger, because wealth has been seized by a very few minority in just about every country of the world nowadays. And as you are aware, the socialist revolution, or the social revolution, took place because of this reason. When the wealth was amassed by a few, then the majority exuded revolutionary groups that called for socialism, which means participation of all in wealth and not deprivation of the majority of wealth.
Thank you. There is, as you know, in the newspapers in Libya and in general discussions of reform, of a need to think about the global market and so forth and so on. You've presented a picture that really is very much what Libya can offer to the world in terms of a system of government and economics and so forth. Can the world offer anything to Libya? Are there things that Libya can learn from the experiments and experience of the rest of the world in thinking about its own development?
Libya certainly will benefit, despite all the negative aspects of the world political or economic system. Nonetheless, Libya would benefit from that system. There are basic economic and political crises in the world, and by virtue of opening our eyes to the world events, Libya would learn from these crises. Now, we see crises and we know their reasons, and therefore we try to remove the causes in order not to run into the same crisis. The question of cooperation in the areas of politics and the economic field is another issue. It has nothing to do with the system of any government. We deal with all countries irrespective of their system, whether it is dictatorial or democratic system. That's a matter for their own people. But we deal with whoever cooperates with us from that state. Of its system, because that system is a matter of their people. We must cooperate, however, as nations, with entities. It's not a question of cooperating with an individual who rules or not. What we say, there are states which we can deal with or we cannot. For instance, is Cuba possible to cooperate with? That is the yardstick. It's not a question of Castro. That's wrong. This is a matter that has to be left for the Cuban people. Iran, for instance. Iran, whether it seeks peace or not, if we decided to cooperate with Iran in the interest of peace, irrespective of who rules Iran. But we should not invoke the question of who rules Iran. These are wrong policies, and they are not beneficial to any party, not to the whole community of the of nations. Scrutinizing and hair-splitting of internal matters in any nation is something that is not good. We would seek cooperation and friendship with those who seek our friendship and cooperation, and we would stand against those who are fighting us and are our enemies. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We've talked a great deal about the sort of sense that there is it's inappropriate for countries to discuss the internal affairs of other countries and so forth. But let us just imagine that there are people in Libya, for example, who disagree with that and think that there should be some room for debate. One of the things that people from outside, in any event, think very often about Libya is that there really isn't as much room for debate, right of free expression and so forth, as there ought to be. And so I'd like to ask you whether there is, in a sense, the sort of basic, you know, the core of many human rights is really the right to be wrong. That is to say, to hold an opinion that is not the prevailing opinion, but it is an opinion that is freely expressed, peacefully advocated, and it may be a minority position, but people are free to express it. Can you talk a little bit about how you see the rights of people to be critical of the policies of the Libyan system?
First, the Libyan system is a system for all people. If one criticizes the system, that person is criticizing himself or herself, because any man or woman in Libya is a participant in the creation of this system and its policy. Domestic foreign policies and legislation is developed by all all people who are adults. These are the ones who are responsible for this system, and if someone from these criticizes this, that criticism is a criticism for the person. And those who are outside, who have hate, we invite him, please, just join the people's congresses, express your views, say anything. You might say that Libya should be an empire, that is your right. But we cannot deny you the entry to Libya or join the Congress. One might come from a communist country. Let him or her explain to people in Libya the communist system, and they would tell him in the Congress that we disagree with you, and that would save the problems. In any case, everything is open for discussion within the People's Congresses, and a single individual's idea might be endorsed. Now, with regard to human rights, genuine human rights, are not the veneer that we are bubbles in hair, scraps of paper. The right of human rights are the right of human being to determine their destiny. They enact laws and design and develop policies, internal and external. That is the right to self-determination. That is the basic right of human beings. The other right is the right to freedom, to enjoy the fruits of his or her effort, so that the yields of that effort would not be usurped. A laborer who puts in 7 hours of labor should be rewarded on the basis of that effort. There should be no room for exploitation. A free decision is to decide for yourself what you want. These are the basic rights. When these basic rights are neglected that affect the daily life of human beings, and talk about trivial matters that you spoke via telephone and you were under surveillance. Now America is eavesdropping and they are creating another state of terror like what happened in New York. Now the laws enacted in America and other countries give the right to the state to enter the office and browse through the book one is reading in order to know what is the nature of that book. And that is under the pretext that we are trying to safeguard the safety of the society in order to identify who is the terrorist and the non-terrorist, because terrorism has become a danger to all people. What I mean, human rights yesterday were not monitoring secret communications. People have the right to move freely. Now, people have ceased to be free even in terms of what they dress. For instance, France has come to impose on people what to dress. The headscarf for Muslim girls. These are two sides of the same coin. So our values yesterday in terms of human rights now, given the recent changes, have pushed aside those rights. Human rights require living in peace, safe from all forms of terrorism, state-sponsored terrorism, government terrorism, harassment by government, and to live in a system of justice free from exploitation, so that your energy, your effort would not be usurped from you. These are the human rights. These are the human rights.
Thank you. Get to the question. We actually would like to talk to you about terrorism, but I'd like to follow up on human rights one more question, because Libya is a signatory of the International Conventions on Human Rights. And so you said, and I think there's ample evidence for this, that people can discuss and debate various policy positions and questions within the Congresses. But what if I, as a Libyan, were to want to write an article in the newspaper advocating that Libya be an empire? Would I be able to do that? Could I write freely in the newspapers opinions that I have, not simply discuss them in the Congresses?
Of course, one could write with full freedom, and more important, you can submit that to your People's Congress that, for instance, that Libya should be an empire, atheist country, or religious like Taliban, for instance. More important than publication in a newspaper is to express that within the People's Congress so that it could be adopted as a genuine policy. You could publish that in a newspaper, but the newspaper, who owns this paper? An individual. That is not the paper of a free society. The true paper is the paper that is owned by society, expresses its views. All sectors of society should form a committee for media and information to express collective views. In addition, each sector has its own newspaper. For instance, the lawyers' syndicate have their own newspaper that expresses express their views as lawyers. Medical doctors have their own newsletters to express their views. But lawyers, doctors, teachers, laborers, farmers, all their organizations participate in a general people's committee that guides newspapers. All individuals are free to publish their views in those newspapers and express their views in the media with full freedom, irrespective of those views. And the question of that this idea or this notion is unacceptable, that would be held liable. That is a question accepted throughout the world. If you are driving on the wrong side of the road, then the police would give you a traffic violation ticket, and you go to the court. If you throw stones at the neighboring building, then you one is subject to legal responsibility. If you are offensive to someone in the street, then you could be taken to the court. But if we are asked that if someone published an article, why did you take him to the court? Because simply that article was offensive. That violated the law. That's the reason.
In my experience, the Libyan papers do not have a whole range of diverse opinions, but I did see a lot of coverage of your views because of your very important role in Libya. I was wondering, we've heard a lot of self-criticism of the American political system here. We've heard a lot of criticism of the United States from both American and Libyan participants. I'm wondering if you could share with us your sense of the most important problems facing Libya now, and what are the most important challenges that Libya will have to address in the next 10 years?
إذا استمرت الدولة بمفردها مش هتستطيع مواجهة التحديات العالم.
Would not be able to face challenges posed by the world. This is not the case for Libya only. This is the case of any nation state which cannot live by itself. I think even the United States needs some space. That space could be the North and South America. Or that space could be Canada, Mexico, for example, and the like, and even Great Britain. The nation state now cannot face all challenges. For instance, now the world is disturbed because of the bird flu threat. This is just an example. This disease does not recognize national boundaries, and no one single country can face it unless the whole planet Earth, all community of nations cooperated to address it. For instance, other diseases or plights like locust. The nation state cannot face that threat because the requirements of modern age, the challenges are immense that exceed the capability of any single nation state. And therefore, no single state should be under the illusion that I can challenge and I can forge ahead, even the United States or China. All countries, they need some space in order to provide protection and safeguard for them. As long as Libya
you have addressed a number of issues in Libya. You've addressed the problem of housing. You've addressed the issue of fundamentalism. You've addressed the issue of terrorism. I'm sure there are any number of other issues, and there are shortcomings in the way Libya has addressed these issues up to now. And in the spirit of the self-criticism that's characterized much of this conference, I would like to invite you to be critical about the shortcomings in what has happened so far and the most important problems that need to be solved moving forward.
I actually did not understand the thrust of your question perfectly well.
Many people at this conference have been very critical of the American system, both Americans and Libyans. They've talked about challenges for the American political system and shortcomings of the American political system. In that same spirit of critical thinking, I would welcome your thoughts on the most important shortcomings of what you've been able to do so far and your priorities for solving problems moving forward into the future.
That's the nature of life. Problems would continue to persist. History has no end. And we do recognize that in our homeland, we had our own experiences when we were young people. The world was going through the Cold War, and just about everyone was skeptical about how this stage would unfold depending on the arguments and notions put forward. But we are now lucky now because we have a great experience. I, for one, did live in the time of the President Nixon, and I experienced those policies, and we had to face policies of aggression. I lived through the five decades of European experience. In Africa, there have been changes of regimes, and I was a first-hand witness to all those changes. Now we do have a very wealthy experience which we can draw on, and others can benefit from it. We have a very long and rich experience in international policy, so we can, on that basis, face the challenges and shortcomings. We do have the capacity to reorganize ourselves in order to be able to be worthy of living the current stage. I think the policies of regional blocs like the African Union and the strategies of regional blocs is a very good one, and I think it is your own interest that there should be no Moscow rogue state or revolutionary state, terrorist state. That should be eliminated, but it should be part of a larger region. The current policy of Libya now is not the same policy as in the 1970s and the 80s. Now Libya is part of the African Union. Our individual policy, national policy, is not different from the African Union policy. If a certain country could join that region, then it becomes part of the policy of the larger region. And this is an extremely important thing. Let us say that Russian Federation, or rather, both Koreas, North and South, have become one in one space, even with Japan or China, all together. That is better because North Korea could be an evil rogue state seeking weapons of mass destruction. But if it belongs to a larger region, then its policy would become the policy of the entire region. Now the even Cuba, if it became part of the Latin American Union or Central America, for instance, then Cuban policy would become part of that larger region of Central America. If you consider London as an extremist case, then it could be rationalized within that regional space. Therefore, these policies, regional policies, blocs should be promoted and encouraged, and Libya is now part of the African Union, and hopefully we would become to have one single African policy.
You've talked about the international environment. Do you see shortcomings in the domestic environment that are especially urgent to address? You've talked about the shortcomings in the international environment. Would you care to address the challenges and the shortcomings in Libya's domestic environment, the internal affairs of Libya?
In all candor, if we have problems, negative aspects, challenges inside Libya, that is because of social backwardness. I repeat, social backwardness. We suffer from social backwardness because of the long period of colonialism, and we haven't had a fair chance to practice our own politics, our own economic policies. We were under trusteeship, under protection system. Perhaps the trusteeship council of the United Nations still in existence, unfortunately, as if we were treated, as if we were children. Therefore, we are backward in social terms, no question about that. Because opposition in our country is different from opposition in your country. Our opposition resorts to bombs, assassinations, explosions, subversive acts, trained in military camps, and in some cases, before September 11 events, some people supported that opposition because they thought that the opposition in our countries are similar to opposition in other countries. The opposition has to be peaceful. You ask us, why do you oppress opposition in the Middle East? Opposition in the Middle East is quite different from the opposition in advanced countries. Opposition in our countries take the form of explosives, assassinations, killings. As you have seen, how many countries have have seen these things in the name of opposition. This is a manifestation of social backwardness. A thief would escape the country and submit himself as seeking political asylum. In the West, a drug trafficking dealer or a thief would go to another country and seek political asylum. That is not possible at all. That thief would be sought and ask a lawyer to defend himself, but he cannot invoke political asylum. But in our cases, this is quite common for those people in similar cases would go outside and seek political asylum. Any contravention of law, you run outside the country and you pose as someone who's seeking political asylum. That is because of social backwardness. The opposition in our countries is different from the opposition in your country. Our methods are very backward, indeed. And the methods of opposition in our countries are quite different. Even when it comes to demonstrations, for instance, like those that were staged against the cartoons that blasphemed Prophet Muhammad, they resorted to bullets. Police in the West use water hoses, gas, tear gas, but in our countries we don't have tear gas bombs or water hoses. The police officer in our countries act in a backward way because socially he belongs to a backward social system. That's how we react.
Let me follow up on that a little bit and ask you to talk about, in a sense, how a system like Libya's thinks about bringing up the next generations. I mean, clearly, social backwardness is something that education addresses, that economic change addresses, so forth. How are you thinking about the impact of education and whether your systems of education are really equipping the next generation of Libyans to deal with the problems that all countries are going to be confronting in the 21st century?
We must admit that the education system is backward. I'm not happy at all with the school curriculum, the methods of examination, admission of students to colleges, the way they are applied now. And indeed, we have to start with education. This is quite appropriate. We must have an advanced, liberal curriculum system that would not impose any restrictions on the pursuit of science and knowledge. Now, in some Islamic countries, scientific research is prohibited because they something that this is contrary to the teachings of religion. If religion cannot stand the test of science, then that is not religion. We should not be afraid of any scientific research. But in a good number of Islamic countries, their school curricula would prohibit many scientific research disciplines because of backwardness. In some Arab Islamic countries that are known to you, fetus inside the womb of the pregnant woman is prohibited because only God, to some people, think that knows the sex, the gender of that fetus. How could that be prohibited? That is because of backwardness. Our system, educational system, should bring up a modern, educated, well-trained generation of young people who would face the challenges of the modern age. And And indeed, we should start with education. And after this question, may I just accept one more question, because my time would have run out. And I do thank you in advance for your efforts.
Well, thank you very much. I actually, since we're on education and we are, of course, sitting in a university, I want to perhaps use that as a vehicle to talk to you a little bit and ask your opinion about whether there are educational opportunities that are now being presented to Libyans as a result of the renewed engagement that Libya has with the rest of the world. Are there things that you expect the universities, the secondary schools to begin to reflect as a result of these renewed relations?
Of course, the place that was close to us was America. Now, with the improvement in relations, we do hope that our students would be able to study in American universities, including this distinguished university of yours, that is Columbia University. We do hope that their number, if some of them are there, would increase, and this would be of great service to us if we are provided with chances to acquire knowledge in advanced countries like the United States. We do need that, and indeed we do welcome this, and we welcome also any professors who would come from the United States, Europe, and other advanced nations in order to come and teach our students in our country.
Thank you very much, sir, and thank you for joining us in this dialogue.
Thank you.
It was building. Thank you all very much. We have an opportunity now for a little bit of a breather, some informal conversation.